Welcome back. We saw in the first video how homeopathy has unscientific roots based on one man's assertions and his half-assed job of testing his ideas. We saw how it is neither science nor medicine at a fundamental level. In this video, we'll look at what it takes to become a homeopath and see how accurate homeopaths are in their claims of evidence. Many British universities closed most or all of their alternative medicine courses in the late 2000s. By 2010, UCAS was showing no homeopathy degree courses. While there are still a number of places running homeopathy courses, the Centre for Homeopathic Education appears to be the only one left in Britain where you can study for a Bachelor of Science degree. You can study part-time for 4 years. Saying you've studied for 4 years sounds impressive, but at 10 weekends per year, this is just 80 days of tuition in total. In the first year's 10 weekends, 27 topics are covered. This gives each an average of a little over 5 hours tuition time, assuming an hour for lunch. Clinical training begins in year two, taking 1 day per month. This is actually half of that year's course time. In the other 10 days, you learn the rest of the year's syllabus. In year three, as well as taking cases and prescribing to patients, you learn new styles of prescribing, understanding energy systems, nutrition, herbal remedies, and a vast range of therapeutic remedies. Two immediate questions the potential student should be asking would seem to be, how much detail of that vast range can you go into as part of 10 weekends formal tuition? And what evidence is there that the vast range of remedies has any therapeutic value, given that the proving process of homeopathy is so drastically flawed, and that most of them have had no proper testing? Interestingly, in year three you also get to learn critical reading skills and understanding statistics in research papers. This should give you all the tools you need to understand that homeopathy is statistically no better than placebo. In the fourth year, you focus on gaining all the tools necessary for professional practice. You learn complex casework and complex prescribing. It isn't clear how complex prescribing no active ingredients can get. Business skills and practice management are a highlight of the year. If there were that much to homeopathy, though, one might expect a highlight of the year to be something of clinical value rather than a business studies unit. With regards to clinical training, this takes place at a pharmacy in London. There are only so many hours in a day, and homeopaths generally make much of their longer consultation times. Depending on footfall and number of students training, it seems unlikely that each trainee will spend all day getting direct experience. This is probably why you only need to clock up a minimum of 10 hours under supervision in year 3, being 1 hour per weekend, and 12 in year 4. The upshot is that after a minimum of just 22 hours of supervision in a clinical setting, you're good enough to start your own practice. A full-time course is also offered. That's 3 years of study. In this case, full-time has the curious property of being just 2 days per week, 3 weeks a month, over 3 terms. Some might say that spending a third of the week doing something isn't full-time. Clinical training, again, is just 1 day per month. Wherever you learn homeopathy, it seems only appropriate that the courses appear to be somewhat dilute. Since homeopathy wants to be regarded as a credible system of medicine, it's only fair to compare its courses to those of medicine. For an example, let's consider the 6-year MBBS BSc course taught at Imerial College London. Let's start with entry requirements. As a minimum, you need 3 A-levels, including chemistry and or biology, and 1 science or mathematics subject, and 1 additional subject at AS level. Oh, and you really need those A-levels to be all A's. You also need to pass a BMAT test, designed to test the skills and knowledge that you're expected to have in place. For homeopathy, the preference is 5 GCSEs and 2 A-levels. If you haven't got any, don't worry, you can apply anyway. All you actually need is sufficient previous work and life experience, and you don't need to have studied chemistry or biology. You can make up for not having done so as part of your 10 weekends per year. While you can be sure that someone who has studied medicine is a highly intelligent and capable individual, you have no such guarantees with a homeopath. So what about the content of the medicine degree? Instead of learning about Samuel Hahnemann and his physics-defying horseshit, which we covered in part 1, you spend the first 2 years focused on 3 core elements. One will be particularly alien to homeopaths: the scientific basis of medicine. You'll also be learning about molecular and cell biology, genetics, blood, infection, immunity, cell pathology, cancer, the skin, cardiovascular system, respiratory system, alimentary and urinary systems, anatomy, neuroscience and mental health, endocrine and musculoskeletal systems, more anatomy, pharmacology, and so on and so on. In the homeopathic world, you can cover this in just a few weekends, of course. On the medicine course, you do some work with patients in years 1 and 2, but the real meat begins in year 3, with 3 10-week clinical attachments in hospitals. Then, of course, there's another 3 years of work on top of that. You spend year 4 working towards the BSc by undertaking a series of modules and a supervised research project or a specialist course in an area of particular scientific or medical interest. Year 5 includes a dedicated pathology course, followed by a selection of clinical specialities. Year 6 includes 3 7-week clinical attachments, professional work experience in medicine and surgery, and specialised study modules and private study periods. So, in total, you've done at least 51 weeks of work in a clinical setting. A bit more than the 22 hours becoming a homeo quack. To practice medicine, you need to be fully registered with the General Medical Council and have a license. As a charlatan, no license is necessary. Homeopaths have got around this with some spin. Many courses award a licentiate, and in doing so, heavily imply that you are licensed in some way. For an example, the Contemporary College of Homeopathy implies that its qualification permits you to practice as a homeopath, but you do not need a license or any permission in the United Kingdom. Once you've become a homeopath, you can register with a number of different organisations to give your quackery some gloss. In the UK, the Society of Homeopaths is the largest registering organisation. On April 10th, 2012, it joined the homeopathic chorus crowing about what it called the Swiss Health Technology Assessment Report, or HTA. They're referring to a review called Homeopathy in Healthcare, Effectiveness, Appropriateness, Safety, Costs, by Bornhoft and Mattison. Originally prepared in 2006, it was translated into English and embellished at the end of 2011. Homeoquacks have been parading it ever since. The Society implies heavily that it was a government report. Homeopathic proselytiser Dana Ullman goes a step further in an article that has hawed its way across the homeopathic web space. In late 2011, the Swiss government's report on homeopathic medicine represents the most comprehensive evaluation of homeopathic medicine ever written by a government. Homeopaths do seem to get the wrong end of the stick on a regular basis when making their statements. It's probably just a coincidence. The publication that Ullman and the Society of Homeopaths are referring to was not actually a health technology assessment and was not written by the Swiss government at all. Don't take my word for it though, take the word of Felix Gertner of the Federal Office of Public Health in Switzerland in his letter to the editor of Swiss Medical Weekly. The report, Homeopathy in Healthcare, Effectiveness, Appropriateness, Safety, Costs, is not a Swiss report. What we find in here is that the publication that homeopaths love was one of 2 literature reviews commissioned concerning homeopathy. The final PEC report does not classify the literature reviews as HTA reports. It was declared to be an HTA by its authors and published later as a book under their responsibility without any consent of the Swiss government or administration. It was also written by apologists for alternative medicine. So, people with a vested interest in homeopathy write a review about an actual government report, give it considerable spin, call it an HTA to confuse it with the actual HTAs, and publish it without authority of the government. You can probably tell where this is headed. The Society of Homeopaths lauds the publication as an unambiguous endorsement of the evidence base for homeopathy as a clinically effective system of medicine. The implication is clear. The entire system of homeopathy has been unambiguously endorsed as clinically effective, and all with just a single report. Bollocks. It only considered studies for upper respiratory tract infections and allergies. Any findings, even if valid, cannot be extrapolated to any other ailment, and so cannot be taken as unambiguous endorsement of homeopathy as a whole. The real HTA, along with reports for 4 other alternative medicines, was submitted to be part of the overall report by the Complementary Medicine Evaluation Programme, or PEK. its panel was led by two lawyers, and the overall result was inconclusive. That's why, in June 2005, the Swiss government removed coverage of those five alternative medicines from its compulsory health insurance scheme. A strange thing for a government to do if it unambiguously endorses something. The PEK panel concluded of homeopathy, "The positive interpretation of the current evidence seems understandable, as long as one does not require especially high evidence standards, given the low plausibility of homeopathy in the light of established scientific knowledge." Very sceptical people will regard the reviewed evidence as not very convincing. It also said, "It is very obvious that all or some of the authors have a positive attitude towards the treatments in question, or are convinced about their efficacy. Unquestionably, strict proponents of the usual hierarchy of evidence will regard the presented evaluations as scientifically untenable and unreasonably positive." One also doesn't have to look far in the PEK report to find that, in the view of the authors of the meta-analyses, the available placebo-controlled studies on homeopathy do not demonstrate any clear effect over and above placebo. Homeopaths don't seem to have included these conclusions of the PEK in their articles claiming that the Swiss government endorses their horseshit, though. The Society of Homeopaths news article continues by saying that the report also dismissed the claims of the only research study ever to conclude that homeopathy's effects are due to placebo, the controversial Shang meta-analysis, published in The Lancet and heralded as the end of homeopathy. Well, it would do. In the homeopathy world, any paper that doesn't agree with homeopathy is a bad paper, but as we'll see later, even papers that don't offer a case for homeopathy can be transformed into ones that do. Felix Gertner of the Federal Office of Public Health mentioned that the Swiss government commissioned two literature reports. The first was a meta-analysis of homeopathy trials, reference 6. Look, it's the Shang meta-analysis, published in The Lancet in 2005. And yes, it was funded by the Complementary Medicine Evaluation Programme of the Swiss Federal Office for Public Health. The PEK achieved what it set out to do: evaluate the evidence for alternative medicines. Those with a vested interest in them have since tried to rewrite the findings of the Swiss government. The Shang paper, which homeopaths attempt to discredit, concludes, "When account was taken for these biases in the analysis, there was weak evidence for a specific effect of homeopathic remedies, but strong evidence for specific effects of conventional interventions. This finding is compatible with the notion that the clinical effects of homeopathy are placebo effects." Having studied 110 homeopathy trials and 110 matched conventional medicine trials, one might expect that if homeopathy were better than placebo, there would be some statistical evidence. None was found. Of course, homeopaths don't like this conclusion. We have a book falsely called an HTA, falsely attributed to the Swiss government, and we have homeopaths further rewriting events to claim that the Swiss government endorses homeopathy when it does not. The Society of Homeopaths closed their news piece with, "We hope that the debate will finally move from the question, does homeopathy work, to the more pressing questions of how does homeopathy work, and what conditions can homeopathy treat effectively and cost-efficiently." Homeopaths have had 200 years to show that their charlatanry is better than placebo. Since the PEK found no clear effect over and above placebo, determining how it works is not a more pressing question when there is no evidence of efficacy in the first place. The British House of Commons evidence check of 2009-10 stated, "There has been enough testing of homeopathy, and plenty of evidence showing that it is not efficacious, and we cannot see how further research on the efficacy of homeopathy is justified in the face of competing priorities. And it is also unethical to enter patients into trials to answer questions that have been settled already. And we do not doubt that homeopathy makes some patients feel better. However, patient satisfaction can occur through a placebo effect alone, and therefore does not prove the efficacy of homeopathic interventions. Yet homeopaths still appeal for further studies to figure it out. They think they're playing with a special kind of die, the kind where you get the answer you want, or you get to roll again ad infinitum. Of course, if you don't get the answer you want, you can always claim that governments support your woo-woo when they clearly don't. Both are how lobbying is done, not science." Although the Swiss government ended its reimbursement of homeopathy in June 2005, a public referendum resulted in a temporary reprieve in 2012. This is not an argument in favour of homeopathy either. Homeopaths must now provide evidence of efficacy, appropriateness and cost-effectiveness in 2015. If the evidence provided is inadequate, reimbursement by the Swiss government will cease in 2017. But we can expect more lobbying to be done. Once again, we find the Swiss government's response to be utterly inconsistent with an unambiguous endorsement of the evidence base of homeopathy. Homeopathy persists, despite its utter inability to work, because of intense lobbying and repeated misrepresentations by homeopaths. They need to employ such tactics, of course, because homeopathy is bollocks. In the next video, we'll see what the Advertising Standards Authority had to say when it looked at claims of evidence made by the Society of Homeopaths, before moving on to look in detail at some specific papers claimed by homeopaths to support their woo-woo. See you then.